This is a first principle derivation, and if you have this, you understand the first principles, you're on solid ground. You have a solid foundation. So if you get this one to start things off, you're in a great place for the rest of the test. So have you guys been practicing this?
Yes.
Okay, so it should go much, much quicker this time. Okay, now I want to start out with just a few things before we start. Once again, little kt, and should I put a little subscript here?
Yeah.
On the k? A little subscript b. What is that? What is kt?
The Boltzmann constant.
It's the Boltzmann constant, which is equal to what?
It's r over,
it's the gas constant divided by Avogadro's number. So it represents the amount of energy contained in a what?
Molecule.
In one molecule but the amount of energy contained in a what of a molecule?
Vibrational degree of freedom.
Absolutely. So this represents, so KBT is, we'll just define it as, more about that before we move on. If that's the amount of energy contained in a vibrational degree of freedom, what types of energy are there? Basically two types. What are they?
Kinetic and potential energy.
Yeah, kinetic energy and potential energy. And since the energy, what do we know from equal partition of energy?
It's distributed each one equally.
Yeah. Each degree of freedom gets equal share of the energy. It has to be shared equally. Therefore, half of this that there exists is demanded by what principle is it?
Equal partition of energy.
Equal partition of energy. So at thermal equilibrium, this condition has to be satisfied. And since this is so, there exists how much energy in a vibrational degree of freedom for a mole of molecules?
8.31.
Well, no. No. Since this is the gas constant divided by Avogadro's number, how much energy is there going to be for a mole, per mole?
Gas constant?
Yeah. There exists RT for every mole. At temperature T. Okay. We needed that before we get started. And point I want a diagram before we attack the actual problem. Now, this is, what is Q here?
Reaction.
It's the reaction coordinate. And it corresponds to what?
Progress of the reaction.
The reaction progress. We're going to be doing the reaction profile, the energy profile. G corresponds to the Gibbs free energy. So we're going to track the Gibbs free energy of the reaction as it proceeds. And we're talking about an elementary process. So Q corresponds to the reaction coordinate. What does Q actually correspond to here? Q is what? Yes, for a vibrational degree of freedom, for what? For the supermolecule, we call it, we have lots of names for the supermolecule. The transition state, or what was it again?
Activated complex.
The activated complex. And in this case, we're going to be talking about a simple elementary process where we have A plus B combining, going to form some form of activated complex as the process proceeds. This arrangement of atoms at the top and of the energy profile is a supermolecule called the activated complex or the transition state. And it has a transitory existence, okay? So, one of the fundamental assumptions is that as soon as this activated complex forms, it's gonna go on to either form products or it's gonna be reflected back to reactants. And so we're gonna be interested in the when we talk about it, the rate, because it's an elementary process, is going to be equal to, well, here, A plus B, with some sort of reaction rate constant, going to form the activated complex, which then goes on. Okay? So we're interested in the rate at which this process is going to go. Now, I guess I'll use that as enough background material, and now let's approach the problem itself. And the problem is, for this elementary process, and given this rate law, and also, and now I gotta go over this board. Thank you. So this is the problem as it's stated. And I give you the information that we have this universal frequency factor, which is equal to the Boltzmann constant, or is equal to KBT divided by Planck's constant. And I'm also telling you that the enthalpy of activation is equal to the activation energy minus RT. Before we start, why? Why this and why that? Well, we're going to be, yes, because we're going to be using them later on. Yeah.
The part is for the loss of green energy.
Yes, this part. The enthalpy of activation is equal to the activation energy minus RT, and we've already denoted RT as the amount of energy available for a mole of molecules for a vibrational degree of freedom. So this is the lost degree of freedom. Okay, and so the enthalpy of activation is equal to the activation energy minus the energy lost for the lost vibrational degree of freedom. Now, when we're gaining or losing a degree of freedom, let's say I'm creating a degree of freedom. Is that an endothermic or an endergic process or an exothermic?
Endo.
It's endergic, so it's endothermic. So, in other words, that corresponds to going up the energy barrier. We're creating a degree of freedom. And so the energy has to come from somewhere. Where does that, Gesundheit? Where does that energy come from?
It's a degree of freedom in the active complex.
From all the other degrees of freedom available in the system.
So the Gibbs free energy, the more free energy there is, the more entropy there is too then, right?
The more
vibrational degrees of freedom you would have?
Well, what's happening is, as I'm creating a degree of freedom, it has to get its energy from somewhere. It's never created or destroyed. It has to come from somewhere, and it has to go to somewhere. Okay, and so when I'm on this part of the curve, as I'm creating this new vibrational degree of freedom, as these molecules are coming together to form this activated complex, that corresponds to creating a new degree of freedom.
Okay.
And so that means energy is being taken from the existing degrees of freedom, because equal partition of energy demands that they all get equal share. Okay, so that's why it's an endothermic process when a degree of freedom is being created. And what about when one is being lost? It's exothermic. In other words, as I go past this point, I start to come down, I've lost that degree of freedom. And so that energy is never destroyed.
See, it can get confused that, like, if you're losing a degree of freedom and it goes down on the y-axis, you could look at it sort of as entropy, couldn't you?
Well,
I know you don't want to, but
that is confusing the issue. Think of it in terms of the best example would be when we were doing phase transitions.
Okay.
When we're like, for example, when I'm going from the liquid state to the gaseous state, I can sit and heat the sample as much as I want. I can put Bunsen burner on, so I can put a blowtorch on that boiling liquid. If I have a thermometer in the liquid, the temperature of the liquid doesn't go up at all, does it?
Okay.
And that's because the energy is being pumped into it. Where's that energy going? It's going into the new degrees of freedom that exist in the gaseous state, that we're not there. There are more degrees of freedom available to the gas than there were available to the liquid. And the same applies when we're going from a solid to the liquid, or liquid to the solid. The other way, going the other way, if I have a supercooling, or if I have a gas that's condensing. There's the energy released as the gas cools down, but then when it condenses, there's a tremendous amount of heat that's released called the heat of vaporization. That is going, being released because degrees of freedom are lost.
Okay.
The degrees of freedom that existed in the gas phase no longer exist, and their energy has to go somewhere.
Okay.
So it goes into the existing degrees of freedom of the system and is released as a tremendous amount of heat. And
I see.
And it's observed, you know, you see a temperature. Kinetic energy is consistent with that. So I just wanted to bring out that point for this. Now, what about this? This is the universal frequency factor. And does it make sense in its form? What did we say KBT corresponds to? But it corresponds to the energy of a one vibration, right? Divided by Planck's constant. So doesn't that sort of demand, it's an energy divided by Planck's constant. What's that going to give us units of?
What's Planck's constant again?
Oh, 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34 joules seconds.
Okay.
But Planck's constant, if you'll recall, so first, before we start, recall that E, Planck's constant times the frequency. Okay. And therefore, over Planck's constant. And that's where we get this universal frequency factor. Okay, so what we're saying and what the universal frequency factor corresponds to in this, like all frequency factors, the frequency factor in the Arrhenius expression and the frequency factor in this case, what does it correspond to physically?
How often it will happen?
Well, it let's
fastest rate of energy can occur.
The maximum. The maximum possible rate that a reaction can happen. So the universal frequency factor, it's the maximum physical possible rate at which a reaction can occur, and it has to have the same units as a rate constant. So now, let's attack this particular problem. So this is what we're set out to do. And so what do I start with? The rate law? Okay, yeah. The rate is equal to Gesundheit, whoever sneezed. The rate is equal to the rate constant. Since this is an elementary process, a simple bimolecular elementary process, we can write the rate law directly. Okay? And so this K is not the same K, it's just it represents the rate constant itself. And we can write this directly. And we're saying that this corresponds to this universal frequency factor times the concentration of the activated complex. So we're saying the rate at which this process is going to occur is a commensurate to. As soon as this forms, it's going to go off at this frequency to products. And in this derivation, we're neglecting it reflecting back. But no loss in generality here as far as this is getting all the same features. Now, I'm just going to rearrange this a little bit to solve for K is going to be equal to this universal frequency factor. Now, what does this look like?
Mass action.
That's the mass action law, or the equilibrium constant. Okay, because this is the exact same form as an equilibrium. So we can go on and say that this is equal to this frequency factor, double dagger, times uppercase K, double dagger. Now that we have an expression that involves an equilibrium constant, we can evoke thermodynamics. Okay? And so we know from thermodynamics what? K double dagger equals what?
Joule.
the regular K is no different. This is a mass action. Yeah. E to the what? Okay. And we also know from thermodynamics that this is equal to what? So we can substitute in. And all we're doing is substituting in the known relation corresponding to delta G double dagger, or delta G period. Okay. Now, I can factor this using rules with exponents. And the first thing we have to do is distribute the negative sign inside the parentheses. And I'm going to rewrite this. And when I have either a sum or difference of anything in an exponent, what do the rules of exponents tell me to do? So it's going to be, yeah, but what do the rules of the exponents tell me to do? If I have, what? You multiply, exactly. So if I have to add, I multiply. And so this is going to be equal to E to the minus delta H double dagger over RT times E, and I distribute the minus, a minus becomes a plus, T divided by T is 1, so it's E to the delta S double dagger over R. Okay. And now we can take advantage of the known expression for the enthalpy of activation. And I can substitute that in for the enthalpy of activation up here. I'm going to rearrange it and say the K double dagger is equal to E delta S double dagger over R times E to the minus E sub A minus RT over RT. And then I can do the same thing we just did before. And factor that. That is equal to E to the delta S double dagger over R. I'm going to pull this RT over RT minus times a minus is plus. I can pull that's RT over RT is 1. So I can pull that through times E to the minus E sub A over RT, which is the expression for for what? E to the minus, this is the activation energy. What does this expression remind you of? The Arrhenius expression. And this is the Boltzmann factor. So you can recall Arrhenius' law that K is equal to A times E to the minus E sub A over RT. And now this is the same K we're solving for. So we know the rate constant is equal to some sort of a frequency factor times a Boltzmann factor. And recognize that here we have it. Okay? And so I'm going to now re-express this K as equal to the universal frequency factor, double dagger, times K double dagger, which I can now substitute this in for. I'm going to pull the E all the way through to the left, E to the minus, or E to the delta S double dagger over R, times E to the minus E sub A over RT. And so this essentially, somebody asked, I think last time, if this would be an adequate answer, and the answer would be yes. Well, we can go on and point out that this shows us clearly that therefore A, which is the experimentally observable frequency factor has to be equal to the universal frequency factor times E to the delta S double dagger over R. And that is why Henry Eyring derived all this to begin with. This is an experimentally accessible, easily found parameter, the frequency factor. And the activation energy is the other easily found experimental factor, which we find from the Arrhenius expression. So given those two, we can now find the activation parameters delta S double dagger and the enthalpy of activation delta H double dagger, which are revealing about the activated complex, which can never be detected because it does not have an existence that is longer than one molecular vibration. So it can never be detected, but we can know as much about it as possible. And the most revealing, I think, of the things we get from it is the entropy of activation. The enthalpy of activation is revealing, but not as much. It's the entropy of activation which tells us the greatest. So are there any questions about this before we proceed?
So Henry Eyring is the guy that came up with entropy of activation.
He came up with the double dagger. He's the one who applied thermodynamics to kinetics. It was Henry Eyring. And so this is associated with his work. And unfortunately, the double dagger was born because his secretary did not, when he gave the manuscript to his secretary, she did not have a key for the little squiggly figure that he'd invented for his work. And so she took a T and then scrolled the typewriter up a little bit, put a dash on it. And that was the birth of the double dagger, which has been used ever since. Okay? So, any questions about this before we proceed? Everybody knows. You will have this down. It's the first question on the test. I guarantee it. Practice this. Know what everything means and be able to do it. Okay? So, having stated that, I'm going to follow a little bit of a different sequence and talk about one of the things we didn't get a chance to discuss last time. And that would be question 15 at the very end. Well, the one at the end. I'll write the question up here in a minute, okay? I guess, is that the actual 15?
Yes.
Okay, so it even corresponds to that. Now, I want you to include
Resume pi.
Okay. That's the question. And I'm just going to cut to the last part of the question so we can get it out of the way. How long is a piece of string? Very good. Yes. So we've got that out of the way. How long is a piece of string, for those of you who couldn't hear him, is twice the distance from the middle to the ends.
How about as long as you cut it?
That's a good answer, too. About yay by so. Anyway, that was part, yeah. So now, A. This is part A of the question. So this is an SN2 process. We want to basically draw the energy profile, and you're given this blank diagram where you're given G and Q again. And since it is exothermic, I should have said exergic. What do we know?
Early transition state.
That the energy, well, yeah, we know there's going to be an early transition state. We also know what's the energy of the products going to be relative to the energy of the reactants. It's going to be negative delta G. Okay, so that means if I start around here, I'm going to end up where? Here or here? I'm going to end up down here.
Negative delta G naught.
Yeah, delta G naught, which corresponds to the free energy of the reaction. So I can now and that was a real try to draw a little smoother line. And this is A, or wait. CH3 methyl iodide plus hydroxide, and this is methanol plus iodide. Now, where's delta G not going to be?
Between those two lines, you drew the reactants.
Yeah, the difference between the reactants and the products is the free energy of the reaction. Where is what's delta G double dagger going to be?
Reactants
and activated complex. So delta G double dagger is denoted here. And last but certainly not least, and I hope I left myself enough room. What was it you said, Trevor, about what do we know about the transition state of the activated complex?
Early.
It's going to be an early transition state. That's whose postulate?
Hammond's postulate.
So Hammond's postulate is, one time remind me, what is Hammond's postulate? It's about the activated complex.
If it's early, it favors the reactants.
Yeah, or the activated complex is going to resemble whichever side in energy it's closest to. So if I have an exothermic process and it's an elementary process, the activated complex is going to look more like reactants than products. And if I have an endothermic process, it's going to look like products. What if it's thermally neutral? Delta G equals zero.
It's not going to look like either one is going to look like a...
It'll be a symmetric case.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. You can get, I guarantee you a question like this on the test, and it's either going to be early, late, or symmetric. Okay. And so now I want to draw the activated complex, and it looks more like methyl iodide than methanol. And recall from 1A, what type of geometry would I expect for methyl iodide? It's going to be tetrahedral. So I'm going to have something like the iodide. It's going to have that type of a geometry. And what are the characteristics of an SN2 process? What is it? What mode of attack is there?
Backside
attack. Sneaky. In other words, the incoming nucleophile is going to be located where as it attacks the substrate? From what? The leaving group. Okay. And the leaving group in this case is the iodide, and the nucleophile is the hydroxide. So I'm going to want to draw the hydroxide. So I'll draw the HO here, dot, dot, dot. And it's going to be 180 degrees opposite here. So I'll draw the and that is an early transition state. The leaving group, the bond is partially broken, the bond being made between the incoming hydroxide. But you'll note that the geometry more resembles the methyl iodide than it would methanol. With methanol, the geometry would look like this. Again, it's going to be tetrahedral, but with the hydrogens puckered away from the hydroxide. Okay? So that is, well, it's back, the next question. After we've drawn this, this takes care of part A. B was okay. Part B was the entropy of activation negative or positive?
Negative.
It's negative. Okay, so we'll just write the answer here, and then I'm going to want to talk about it a minute. Just let it go. Why? I hate that word. Why is it negative? True and true. Less chaotic, more ordered.
Yes, from two things to one.
Yes, going from two to one. And let's recall Boltzmann's, the entropy is equal to KB times the natural log of, usually it's omega, but oftentimes it's denoted with an uppercase W, right? where this corresponds to the number of microstates available. Okay? And that it is the exponent of that. And since n w is equal to, in this case, for positional entropy, in terms of positional entropy, c times v raised to the power of n for n particles. Okay? So now we can see the underlying reason that the entropy has to be negative. Because we're n is the exponent here of, this is just a constant, which has to do with how many positions are available within a given volume V. So it doesn't matter about that. The point is the number of particles appears in the exponent. And since if we look back at the reaction, I've got methyl iodide and a hydroxide reactants, and I'm going to an activated complex where I have one molecule, I have two molecules here, I have one molecule there. And therefore, this number is getting smaller. Delta S has to be negative. We're going, and now we can use the words order and chaos and all that other hand-wavy stuff that people like to do when they talk about entropy. But it has a statistical origin, as Boltzmann showed. So does that make that answer clear? Because this can find its way into one of those well-loved multiple-choice questions that everybody likes so much. Okay. Now does everybody understand why it's negative? Any questions? Okay, so now that answers question B. All you need to put, by the way, is one word negative. You don't need any of this, but you want to understand why rather than simply write the answers because I could ask a different question or you could have a different set of circumstances. Okay. Now, part C was, what effect would increasing the polarity of the solvent have on the rate of reaction? That I'm going to have to get over here on this board. And let's talk about it a little bit. Let's look at the reaction. And understand why the answer is so. Well, what type of, what characteristic here is going to be the key feature? What?
The hydroxide ion,
which is fully charged in the reaction, right? For the reactants. And I have an iodide ion, which is fully charged, bears a full-blown charge localized on an iodide atom. And the hydroxide has a full-blown charge localized on the hydroxide ion, whereas what type of situation exists in the transition state?
Spread out.
Yeah, it's dispersed.
I have. Mine is the solvent. No, that's a stupid question. But which one's the solvent?
I'm just saying increasing the polarity of the solvent. In this reaction, it was water.
Okay.
But I'm saying I could change that to a different solvent. or I could do something to it that would increase the polarity. You know, there are some things you can do, but like add salt to it, salt effect, etc. Now, in the transition state, in the activated complex, the charge is diffused over the entire molecule, or dispersed over the entire molecule, and so it is not as focused as it is in the reactants where I have a full-blown charge. So what is that going to do? If I increase the polarity, what type of interactions am I talking about? Between the solvent, what's the relevant interaction? What would the, how would the polarity impact that? What do polar molecules have? They have what?
Dipole.
They have a dipole. They have a permanent dipole. And so what type of interactions are we talking about here? Ion dipole, right? So the dipoles tend to do what when there's an ion around, when there's a charged atom or molecule around? What does that do to the polar molecules, the dipoles of the polar molecules?
Affects their orientation.
Yeah, they're going to tend to orient in such a way that the negative end of the dipole is going to be directed towards the positive ion, or the positive end of the dipole is going to be directed towards a negative ion. And so that has a tendency to orient the molecules in the solvent. And that type of interaction is going to be favorable. So that's why this is better solvated. This is going to be better solvated than the transition state. And so that means that the delta G double dagger, if I increase the solvent polarity, is actually going to be slightly increased. This is, what do we call it when the solvent molecules are oriented? There's a word for it.
Electrostriction.
Okay. So electrostriction is greater here in the reactants, in the products, than it is in the activated complex. There's less electrostriction. There's less orienting of the solvent molecules, and therefore it's not as favorable, energetically speaking. It's going to raise the activation energy barrier, delta G double dagger, which is going to do what to the rate?
Slow it down.
It's going to slow it down. So what part was this? C? So, and I wrote it down somewhere. Oh. So here's the question, and the answer is, it would slow it down, or decrease the rate. Either of these would be adequate. Any other expression you have that expresses that is going to be a good answer, okay?
Can you give an example of it increasing the
rate? Of it increasing the rate?
Yeah.
And it's going to be slightly in this case. Well, an example where it's going to increase the rate would be one where I had, rather than a charged, because this was, remember there were four charge types when we talked about the SN2 processes? Let's say, instead of this being a charged ion, I had a neutral molecule, like an amine, where it was like, I have a neutral molecule here, and I'd have, well, I don't know what I'd have in the products. All I care about is the neutral molecule here in the reactants. Going to the transition state, there would be a charge buildup. So there would be more charge existing in the transition state than there was in the reactants. In that case, electrostriction is going to be increased as we go to the transition state. So an increase in solvent polarity actually has a dramatic effect on the rate. It's going to enhance the rate because it's going to that favorable solvent-solute interaction is going to lower the activation barrier because we're more favorably solvating the activated complex. We have a lower barrier, we have it is much more pronounced in this case. This would give us a slight decrease in the rate by increasing the solvent polarity. Whereas if we had case one, which was we have a neutral nucleophile, then we'd have a dramatic increase in the rate by increasing the polarity of the solvent.
I thought you had more charged activation complex, like in your first example right there, though, when you have the two iodides, or the one iodide and
hydroxide.
They both have a negative charge.
They have a partial negative charge, but it's distributed over the entire activated complex. It's not as localized. Whereas where here, I've got it localized on the hydroxide ion, and in the products, I've got it localized on the iodide ion. Okay?
And I just wanted an example so I could understand it.
Okay. Does that
better, yeah.
Does that help?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay, cool. And so the answer is slow it down or decrease the rate. Now we got to go to question D, which we've already answered. There's the words I used. Increased. I chose? Yes. So we've already answered that. What is it?
Relaxed.
It's relaxed. Okay. And now part E.
Can you go over why it's relaxed?
Why it's relaxed? Essentially because there's greater electrostriction, or electrostriction means that the solvent molecules are oriented. In other words, the ability to orient them is proportional to the size of the charge. The magnitude of the charge is the same, but it's localized. And so the magnitude of that charge as the solvent molecules approach it, it's going to cause their dipoles to orient. The more localized the charge, the more oriented the solvent molecules are going to be around it. The dipole, ion-dipole interaction is going to orient and order the solvent. And so that's called electrostriction. Electrostriction is more pronounced here. It's relaxed going to the activated complex because the activated complex doesn't have as focused and localized charge. Okay? Is that, Mark, does that answer? Okay. Okay, cool. Okay, what was part E? Oh, this is a tough one. Oh, I'm going to write it in black and then I'll write the answer in purple. Symmetric or late transition state? We already answered this earlier. It's an early. Early transition state. And does everybody remember why? We already talked about this.
Exothermic.
Yeah, because it's an exothermic process. Hammond's postulate states that the activated complex is going to resemble whichever side and energy it's closest to. And it's closer to the reactants, so it's going to be an early transition state. Okay, now, the last one, part F, how long is a piece of string? We already answered that. Twice the distance from the middle to the end. Mm. I had to get some sort of string theory in here. Okay. Now, I thought we would go on to question one, which is a big long one. I think we can get through it quicker this time. And the reason being, what I'm going to take out of question one on the actual test is that you draw anything. But all the principles we've been applying so far are going to definitely apply. Before we leave kinetics, we need to definitely discuss question one, and then we're going to get into a thermodynamic question and an equilibrium question, which is question three. We'll go to question two quickly.
Okay. So, I guess I'll use this board.
Should I use this guy? I'll use this board. Okay. So this is question one. On the real test, it's going to be not question one. We already know it's going to be, that question will be the derivation of activated complex theory. So the following sequence. This is what we're given, and part A, and by the way, this one takes up the whole page. It is going to take up the whole page on the actual test. It's a 100-point question, and I want you all to nail it, okay? What? Yeah. It's 100. We'll get to why it's a 100-point question. Maybe it'll only be 90 points because I'm not taking. I'm maybe taking some things out.
we'll talk about that too. A. So, how do I write the overall reaction? What are we doing with some reactions together?
Move the intermediates, or identify the intermediates.
Identify first, yeah, intermediates, and what else? Possible catalyst. And how am I going to distinguish between an intermediate and a catalyst?
One's from the reactants to the products, and the intermediates from the products, or yeah, products back to the reactants.
Yeah, in other words, an intermediate is produced and then later consumed, and a catalyst is consumed and later produced. Sort of sounds like doublespeak, but the old man with the camel, basically the catalyst enters into the process and then emerges afterwards unscathed. Okay, so what are the, are there any intermediates in this process? Which, what are they? So that's an intermediate. It's produced and then consumed. Any other intermediates? AB3 is produced and then later consumed. Are there any catalyst?
M,
which is consumed and later produced. And so what am I left with?
AB3X plus Y.
And then I write the catalyst over the arrow. And what am I given as a product?
AB3Y plus X.
Okay. So there's 10 points right there. Okay. And we've already answered most of the next parts, but we have to formally write it down where it belongs. Okay, B. What are the intermediates? We've already identified them as and AB3. Any other intermediates? That pretty much answered that one. C, I believe, is which is the rate determining step? And which is the rate determining step, and how do I know that?
Number two.
Number, say it like Lewis Black. Number two. Step two. Why is step two rate determining? Has the highest activation, or the energy of activation. So that means it's going to be the slowest one. And no reaction can proceed faster than its slowest step. Okay, so the answer is step two and now part D. What is the catalyst? We already answered that. We wrote it over the arrow. Well, put it in blue. What is it?
M.
He was a great character in all the 007 movies. Okay. Okay. Now, part E. I'm not going to bring Gravity Mountain up here. I'm going to leave this here so I can do part E on this board. And part E is write the rate law. So what do I have to do?
Start with the 72.
Slowest rate.
Start with the slowest step. And since these are elementary processes, that's going to be the rate is going to be equal to K2 times
KV3 mx.
Okay, and that is, so that's half the problem right there. We've got half of the answer, but it's not complete. Why?
It's an intermediate.
Yeah, it has a concentration of an intermediate, and that's not something that we can control, or even, or we may be able to experimentally observe it, but it's not something that we could likely do a kinetic experiment with. We're going to have an experimentally observed rate law, which is going to be written on is going to contain all of the reactants that we can control, the concentration of, or catalyst, or something that we can control. And so I have to re-express this in terms of things that I can control. And so I can take advantage of the first step as a fast equilibrium. And so, therefore, at equilibrium, what is true for every equilibrium? The rate of the forward reaction is equal to the rate of the reverse reaction, right? And so, since K1 times has to be equal to K minus 1 for the reverse reaction times AB3MX. And I ultimately want to solve for this. But in order to get there, this can either be done on the test, or you could do this on scratch paper. This you have on the actual test itself. Now I'm going to solve this K1 over K minus 1 has to be equal to Now, does this look at all familiar? What is that? That's mass action. So I can just simply put a big K there. Call it K1. Okay? Now that I've got that, and this could be on scratch paper as well, or you, depending on how much room you've got and how small you write. I want you to write legibly, so this could even be on scratch paper. What I want you to have is, on the test itself, the following, at the very least, that the concentration of this intermediate species is equal to the mass action expression times the concentration of the reactant times the concentration of the catalyst. And so now I can substitute this in here and I get the ultimate answer. So the rate is equal to K2, little K2. I can write uppercase K1, mass action, times A, B, X times M. And that answers the question. This would correspond to the observed. This is actually K observed. This would be the experimentally observed rate law. And you could express it without any loss of, you know, in fact, you can write it like this, or you could write it like this. K2 times K little K1 divided by little K minus 1 times Okay. Root? Yeah? 9? Okay. What's the problem? Oh, okay. We're okay? Everybody cool on that? Guarantee, this is, we've just gotten through, okay, that's, I'm tempted to give you more than 10 points for this one. This is the tricky part, so I might add some points on for that.
Very nice.
But then the next part's going to be the real, it's not tricky, it's just a lot. The following. It's part F. And your diagram, the reaction profile. Give you delta G naught is equal to minus 10 kilojoules per mole. Okay. For the reaction. Label. I give you the picture on the right-hand side of the molecules 1, 2, 3, and 4, which is the, I'll go on to describe in a moment. Include delta G naught. Delta G 1 double dagger, delta G2 double dagger, and delta G3 double dagger. Label, transition states. As double dagger 1, double dagger 2, and double dagger 3. Okay? And I give you pictures on the right-hand side of AB3X, AB3MX, AB3 plus Y, and AB3Y. I guess I should point that out up here. You're given. And you're given. So I'll write it up here. AB I'll skip the pictures. I'll just call it AB3X delta G naught 1 is equal to 0. And that's called 1. A, B, 3, M, X, and that is delta G naught 2 is equal to 5 kilojoules per mole, and that's called 2. A, B, 3, plus Y is going to be delta G 3 naught. Delta G naught 3 is equal to 10 kilojoules per mole, and that's 3. And 4 is A, B, 3, Y. And that is 4. Notice I didn't give you a delta G naught there. Why didn't I? I already gave it to you in the very beginning. I said delta G. Delta G naught equals minus, that's for the reaction. Okay? So I give you delta G naught for all the others, and I give you delta G naught of minus 10 kilojoules per mole. That corresponds to the free energy formation of products, 4. So these are the labels. You're going to label this molecule here, you're going to label this molecule here with a 1, this one's a 2, this one's 3, this one's 4. On the energy reaction profile, and you can see it in the key. I'm omitting the pictures, and I'm omitting the early late part of it. Okay? So now let's get back over here and try to draw this piece. Oh, I'm going to need this delta G double dagger business, so I'll leave it up. Oh. I took out step 3. You've got it already on the, you guys have it on there, so I guess I can erase this. You have it on the key and on the problem. Okay, and here we're going to want to sort of figure that we know that it has to be between reactants. So if I have this be, this will be minus 10. This is 0. This is 10. This is 20. This is 30. I'm just sort of, you don't want to bother to put a ruler there, but just sort of in pencil, sort of give yourself an idea so you can locate all of the reactants, products, intermediates, and transition states in the right place. And we start out with, we know we're going to end up here, somewhere around here. Okay? And we know we're going to start out somewhere around here. Okay? And this is going to be 1. This is going to be 4. Now, 2 What did I say the free energy of formation of two was? 5 kilojoules? That's for the first intermediate. So that's going to be somewhere around here. And that's 2. Okay, and now for delta G naught 3 is 10 kilojoules. So that's around here. That's for the next intermediate. And now I want to locate the height of the barriers above it. So for the first transition state, what delta G1 double dagger was what? 15 kilojoules? Okay, so I'm going to want to go up 15 kilojoules and locate myself right about here. And this is going to be double dagger 1. And now I can, now I want to locate what was delta G 2 double dagger? Rate determining step was 20 kilojoules. So I go from 5, 15, 25. Up here. And that's double dagger 2. And then the last double dagger is located 10 kilojoules above this intermediate. So I go up from here 10 kilojoules. And that would be located right about there. And that's double dagger 3. Now I want to draw the prettiest line I can between all of those. So practice this a little bit on scratch paper. Use this one as a good practice run. And using all those, and now I start here. Okay, now I can include, this is why this is a heavy point problem. Oops. This is delta G naught for the reaction. Where's delta G double dagger 1? Between here and here. So delta G double dagger 1 and delta G double dagger 2. Again, it's always from the reactant side to the transition state. And delta G double dagger 3 is here. So this is a heavy point problem, but please note that I'm always talking about the activation barrier as the reaction proceeds, so it is relative to this location, delta G1 is measured, going from reactants to the first transition state, the first activated complex, from the first intermediate to the activated complex. The second activated complex in the rate determining step, I measure the energy from here to the activated complex. And for the third one, it's from here to the activated complex. And so this is a heavy point problem. There are going to be 10 points for just locating 1, 2, 3, and 4. So that's 10 points right there. Okay. I'm not going to care that much about the scale over here. You don't have to be spot on. I just like to use this as a rough guideline, okay? So just try to get as close as you can within the space provided. And you might want to rough it out in pencil so that you get a nice picture before you finally draw the line. Locate all these points. And so there, like I say, 10 points for locating just 1, 2, 3, and 4, 10 points for locating the activated double daggers, the activated complexes, 10 points for the delta G double daggers, and 10 points for drawing my squiggly line, the actual reaction coordinate. So that is 10, 20, 30, 40, and then let's not leave out that. So it's about a 40, 50 point problem. Take your time. I'm going to shave the questions down. I'm going to shave the test down to make it a little more doable. But this part's going to make the cut. So there's going to be a question just like this. Well, it's going to be a little different reaction, maybe different energies, etc. But it's going to look a lot like this. It's going to have all the same features. You're not going to draw the transition states. That part's been removed, okay? So I'm not going to worry about it, but I am going to ask you whether, yes?
So a good way to double check yourself, since you have these on the sides, and we kind of know if they're late or early, we have a double G knot. When it starts early, it's up here, and when it's late, it starts down here. So
yes.
You can kind of see.
Yes.
You can double check yourself.
Right? I'm going to get to that. I haven't even answered that, but yes, exactly. For anybody who didn't hear what she said, and the way to double check yourself on this one is you know that the first transition, is it early or late?
It's late.
Because it's closer in energy to the intermediate than it is to the reactants. So it's a late transition state. Now the second transition state, is it late or early? It's late. Now the third transition state, it's early. Okay, so that's one of the things you can do to check it. And while we're on the subject, this is a sensuous thing. Since she was on the subject.
If it's endergic, it's always late.
Yes.
Exergic, it's always early.
What? Yes.
Okay.
Yes, exactly. If any elementary process is endergic, it's late, and if it's exergic, it's early. And so the last part of this question, the thing that's going to be removed from it is I'm not going to ask you to draw them. You already will be drawing. You're going to do all the drawing you do on the previous question we discussed, question 15. Okay? So I'll expect you to be able to draw just one transition state. That's as fancy as I want to get. I don't want to, make it. This, like I say, I'm not a very good artist. My wife is the artist in our family. I'm certainly not going to require you to draw a lot. Okay, so this is actually marked part F, but it's actually part G. And that is, indicate answered that. Transition state one is, remind me?
Late.
Transition state two is?
Late.
And transition state three is?
Early.
Thank you. Okay, so that concludes that question. It's a heavy point question, and don't be intimidated by it. Just relax. The reason it takes up a whole page, it's going to take some time. We'll try to give you the time. Don't worry, I'm not going to have time constraints on this test.
On the test, could you put Y coordinates just on the actual test? That would make it a lot easier.
You mean put...
Just put those dash lines.
Put the scale on?
Yeah, that'll help.
I will definitely, I'll try to do that. Yeah.
That'd be cool.
I got to get my ChemDraw program to do that, but it's, I can do that. Well, good suggestion.
Or do it by hand and just photocopy it.
I'll do it by hand. I'll figure a way. It's not something that's impossible. If that would help, I will do it. Okay. Good suggestion. Thank you. Okay. Now, the next problem I thought we would do is, or you guys want to take a brief break?
Yeah.
Okay, let's take 5 minutes and we'll come back.